Первое знакомство у меня с ним состоялось очень давно, где-то в 45-м, может быть, или в 6-м году. В общем, мне было порядка 6-7 лет. Знакомство это получилось таким образом. Моя мама, Ольга Михайловна, ее сестра, Дарья Михайловна, были очень верующими людьми. Они ходили в храм, в котором служило в то время два священника. Один из них был отец Никон, другой отец Рафаэль. Они, естественно, как люди еще достаточно мало сведущие в религии, как-то спросили одной монахини, все-таки к какому бы батюшке лучше бы подходить и с кем лучше советоваться. Какой из них более доступен и может принести большую пользу. Эта монахиня была очень такая осторожная, и она скромно сказала, да они оба одинаковые, но все-таки, кажется, батюшка Никон подуховнее. Это определило выбор моей мамы и тети. Так они познакомились с ним, и вот однажды они пригласили его, не помню по какому случаю, к себе домой на чай. Я бегал в это время по улице, и когда увидел, что он идет, то здесь, не знаю уж более к кому обратиться, я подбежал к нему. У меня была настоящая трагедия. Кошка окатилась, а котят к себе не подпускала. Они пищат, а она их не кормит. Я, естественно, обратился к нему, батюшка, смотрите, вот что делать. Он меня погладил по головке, говорит, ну ничего. Я его проводил домой, сели за стол, и меня тоже посадили. И вдруг кто-то с улыбкой показывает на пол. И перед нами, перед всеми, растянулась эта кошка, котята впились в нее, она мурлычет. В общем, полное благоденствие наступило. Я был неописуемо восторгом. Действительно, случай, как кажется, по внешней фабуле, ну, ничего особенного. На самом деле, он, я помню, произвел впечатление на очень многих, поскольку это исцеление кошки произошло моментально. Дальше были уже контакты другого рода. Поскольку мне исполнилось 7 лет и дальше, то меня, естественно, водили в храм. Я исповедовался у батюшки. Он был очень ярким проповедником. Его слово имело огромное воздействие на людей. И сами понимаете, что в ту пору, когда единственным научным мировоззрением был атеизм, и когда церковь рассматривалась как некое реакционное явление, то, естественно, его впечатляющие проповеди, они далеко не воспринимались, далеко не положительно воспринимались властью придержащей, и его переводили с места на место. Из Козельска, то его в Белев, то в Тулу, затем в Смоленск, и, наконец, его перевели в Гжатск, который ныне называется Гагарин. Это случилось в 1948 году. Что такое был Гжатск в то время? Это самый захудалый был городишко, самый захудалый приход, в котором, так сказать, ну, я не знаю, почти никого даже, и почти в храм-то не ходил. В общем, положение было бедственное. Гжатск, он, кстати, находится недалеко от Москвы, в 170 километрах, и железная дорога соединяет его с Москвой. Так вот, когда батюшка Никон переехал туда, то, судя по его письмам и рассказам, он привез с собой два каких-то стареньких подрясников, кстати, от обчинских еще ирмонахов, рясу, алюминиевую посуду, несколько книг, и все. В одном из писем он сообщает: «Меня здесь очень полюбили. Блохи, ши, комары и так далее». Да. И он потом писал, просил, пришлите мне что-нибудь такое, чтобы избавиться от этой любви. Одним словом, он не только попал в условия очень тяжелые материально, но, как мы видим и как мы знали, он сам всегда материально был совершенно не обеспечен.
Игумен Никон, дорогой батюшка, в памяти моей остался как духовный отец, который заботился о моем духовном воспитании. А знакомство с игуменом Никоном произошло еще в те далекие времена, когда продолжалась война Великая Отечественная. Это был 43-44 год, когда батюшка игумен Никон приехал после ссылки в Козельск.
По рассказам тех монахинь, у которых он жил в Козельске, это были монахини еще прежнего Шамардинского монастыря, он в это время был настолько исхудалым, что можно было полагать, что только что человек вернулся из какой-то больницы после страшной болезни. Действительно, это так. В Козельске он занимал в этом доме небольшое пространство, комнатушку, которую сам отгородил себе досками. Это примерно 6-7 каких-то квадратных метров. Но матушки, народ все-таки любопытный, и они так заглядывали иногда. И вот они говорили, удивлялись на него, что как он много времени проводил в молитве. Они просто поражались его этому образу жизни. Как много он полагал земных и прочих поклонов. Постоянно проводил время в чтении Слово Божие, то есть Евангелие и святых отцов. Вообще, они удивлялись, какой подвижнический образ жизни он вел. Кстати, нужно сказать, что в это время, после войны, и многие страдали от недостатка необходимых условий. Питались они в то время. Они сами рассказывали, и рассказывала моя мама,
And my mother told me that
they had almost no food. In a large casserole of soup, there was one spoon of oil, вода, картошка, water, potato,
maybe some
dill, and one spoon of oil. And она My была mother завмагом, и поэтому worked она as a начала store manager, помогать.
And so she
и это
started
буквально спасло,
helping
может быть, и батюшку, и этих монахинь от голода.
Ну
так вот, когда в 48 году он переехал в Гжатск, то, во-первых, из Смоленска, это областной город, предупредили жадских чиновников, что к вам едет проповедник, поэтому будьте настороже. Батюшка потом рассказывал, что он в течение многих лет, очень даже многих лет в Гжатске, постоянно был в напряжении, днем и ночью, спал не раздеваясь. По какой причине?
He didn't get undressed when he was going to sleep. Why? He was waiting to be arrested. Why was there such pressure? The reason is as follows.
Еще когда он впервые, так сказать,
Back then, when he had become a priest,
было
which happened
в 31 году
in
в Минске,
1931
где он
in Minsk,
принял постриг и затем стал священником, то его там арестовали,
he
в Минске.
Had been arrested there in
и
Minsk.
Арестовывали в те времена обычно
and
по ночам.
Times,
подъезжал черный
people
баранок,
were arrested at
давали
night.
Несколько минут на сборы
a minivan
и
arrived.
Увозили.
There were a few minutes
так и он был арестован
to pack your things,
там, в
Минске. And people were arrested.
Там у него были первые допросы.
That's what
совсем
happened
недавно,
to him in Minsk.
Благодаря тому, что стали открывать
he was
архивы КГБ,
interrogated there,
удалось
and when
найти
they opened
очень интересные
the archives of KGB,
сведения
there were
о его допросах.
Ну, interesting
как пишут, тогда ГБУ это называлось,
about
что он был одним из
He was
вождей, что ли,
one of the leaders of reaction and one of the fighters against the Soviet regime. That was the accusation. Of course, he refused to accept all these accusations because he never led any political activity, never did he take part in any political movement. He said, my only conviction is that there is God, that our soul is immortal, and that this is the sense of life, and this is my firm conviction. I don't know if they suggested that he should reject Christ, as they suggested that to many other people, but the interrogators were amazed at his
удивлялись еще одному моменту, который, к сожалению, не столь часто встречался даже в те времена.
And
именно.
At one more
он
thing,
не говорил
which, unfortunately,
ни одного из своих собратьев. Что-то отрицательное, что могло повлечь за собой эти тяжелые последствия, в частности, арест, ссылки и заключения.
Arrest,
вот так в Жацке он начал собственно, если хотите, буквально восстанавливать приход. Можно отметить замечательный просто факт. Если до него очень мало ходило людей в церковь, то здесь постепенно храм стал буквально наполняться. Но если до него богослужение совершало священник только в воскресные дни, то он ввел обязательную литургию в среду, пятницу, субботу, субботу, вечернюю службу и воскресенье.
Батюшка
был
привязан к храму, стремился служить, и бывало он своему второму священнику, которого перевели, бывало скажет, отец Алексей, разреши мне послужить завтра вместо тебя. Он бывало сказал, служи, служи, отец Никона, сколько хочешь, когда хочешь. Ну, даже батюшка, и когда я с ним служил, тоже иногда, частенько он просил меня, чтобы служил он.
Учитывая то, что он, по крайней мере, все воскресные, а иногда и дни даже будние, проповедовал тем людям, которые приходили, можно понять, почему народ стал ходить. Люди почувствовали и силу, я скажу так, благодатную даже силу, на которой присутствовал этот
священник. Is the purity of soul. A person who wants to enter this amazing feast prepared from the very beginning of the world must, above all, listen to God's word and live according to it, according to God's commandments. And any violation of God's will, any violation of any commandment, even of a minor commandment, must be immediately healed and purified by deep and profound repentance. We shouldn't only just say, I am sinful, but with all our humble hearts, turn to God and say, Lord, I sinned, have mercy on me, a sinner, and purify my soul. And if a person all their life tries to follow God's will and commandments, and if they purify every sin with repentance, they get dressed into this wedding garment and they can enter the kingdom of heaven. And a person who only observes some technical commandments, some rites, who is like a Pharisee, will hear from God, "These people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me." Unfortunately, among the Christians today, and I think always, there is no understanding of Christianity, because many people believe that if they come to church from time to time, if they confess and take the communion, they are already the believers, and they say, "I am a believer, and who are you?" So they look down on other people, and this person is like a Pharisee, who is a Christian by appearance, who only honors God with their lips, and their heart is far away from God. And these are also people who are not dressed into the wedding garment and who only think that they are good people. We should have reverence, and we should beware that God wouldn't turn to us and say, "How dare you enter the feast without a dressing garment? Please throw him away." So the image of the future bliss, the image of this amazing feast, is the communion. "He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him." And when we are only Christians who confessed by appearance, as it seems, we said with our tongues, "I am sinful," and our heart doesn't feel that we are sinful. Our heart believes that I am a good person. And in this garment, which is not a wedding garment, without purifying ourselves with the deep repentance, without God's forgiveness, because where there is no repentance, there is no forgiveness, we enter the feast in a dirty garment. Because we must understand that a broken and a contrite heart, this, O God, you will not despise. And if we take the Holy Communion without repentance, God will tell us, "How dare you enter here without a wedding garment?" And he will tell the angels, "Throw him away." And what does it mean when someone is thrown away? That means that the person has no more spiritual development. They are in the dark. They are bound by these terrible passions, and there is no opportunity for them to develop, to purify, until they turn to God with all their heart and repent. He served, of course, not just as a usual priest, but he had a great reverence, and often during the liturgy he had tears in his eyes. And of course he was very disciplined, so No strangers could enter there. He was very strict during the divine service.
Так что мужички,
he didn't allow
которые до этого
anyone
имели обыкновение
the altar.
Стоять там,
and when
конечно, разобиделись на него.
Some people
знаете,
could no longer stand there, they took offense against him. But the strangers should not be in the altar during the divine service.
Там игривые или лирические запрещал.
He didn't allow any
требовал, чтобы он был простым,
artificial singing.
За что, кстати,
and everything had to be read clearly.
Потому
distinctly.
Что, во время крещения, например,
and so
когда тут, знаете, дети,
many people
детей,
didn't like it
читают кое-как,
because sometimes the service is read indistinctly and he demanded to read clearly
том,
and slowly,
seeing that
it's not some pagan cult, it is the great sacrament and service to God.
Не позволял во время пения каких-то криков, знаете, как это бывает, когда или умирание, совсем когда почти ничего не слышно.
You know,
пение при нем было очень ровным, спокойным, умиротворяющим.
So the singing had to be even peaceful, and everyone noticed that.
Я являюсь вдовой.
I am a widow
родного племянника отца Никона Александра Александровича Воробьева. И встречалась с ним после окончания университета, когда мы с мужем были приглашены к нему погостить в его обители около Жатска на окраине. Жатск теперь город Гагарин. То, что он говорил, до сих пор у меня совершенно четко отложилось в моей душе и в моем разуме. Тогда еще я молодой, была женщина, я все я знала. Я интересовалась религией, читала Евангелие, и, в общем-то, считала себя с детства верующей. Но то, что он вложил некоторые мысли в мою голову, до сих пор остаются живыми, и я очень с благодарностью вспоминаю его, хотя уже прошло полвека. Так вот, когда мы беседовали, я запомнила, что он очень отрицательно говорил о одном из важнейших грехов человеческих, это уныние. Он говорил, что уныние как-то уводит человека от Бога, заставляет его заниматься не теми вопросами, какие ему надлежат решить. И может это привести к очень плачевным результатам.
Starts paying
он
too
говорил,
much attention to some unnecessary subjects, and that can end
и
really badly.
Он должен ощущать свою роль и делать, стараться только добро, потому что зло также отвлекает его от хороших дел, от хороших мыслей, что жадность, зависть, ревность, что все эти очень отрицательные энергетические явления противопоказанный человек,
jealousy,
и что не так уж трудно
away from God, жить
по заповеди Божьей. Это поделиться с тем, что у тебя есть ближним своим, не наговаривать на него зло, не брать чужого. Всегда добро отмечается Богом и возвращается человеку с Торицей. Поэтому то, что он говорил о поведении человека, у меня осталось на всю жизнь.
Он родился в 1894 году. Я, например, родился в 1938 году. То есть разница была всего-навсего 44 года. Но он вел себя по отношению ко мне, как старший друг,
начальник, as an elder friend, not as a boss, but as a friend.
And this trait of character
is the best characteristics of him as of a spiritual father. And that's how he was different from other spiritual fathers,
котором идут за решением всех практических, если хотите, вопросов. Он в этом отношении был очень осторожен.
В отношении жизненных вопросов.
Так же, как, кстати, и в отношении духовных вопросов. Его принцип был такой, который, кстати, замечательно виден и в его письмах.
Думаю, что может быть вот так.
Святые отцы по этому вопросу говорят вот следующим образом.
Но, впрочем,
ты смотри, ты лучше знаешь свои обстоятельства, знаешь свои силы, свои возможности, и поэтому тебе решать, принимать окончательное решение тебе. И ты не думай, что у меня будет какая-то обида или расстройство по поводу того, что вот я сказал то-то и поступил иначе. Ну, успокоен.
Вы знаете,
я вам скажу, это редкая встреча такая.
I can reassure you there will be no offense taken. And later I encountered many priests who insisted on their decisions. Sometimes what they give is not a piece of advice, but an order.
Можно видеть, это исходило так, что если человек не исполнит, то это будет уже горькая обида или даже разрыв отношений.
Disagrees,
there would be offense, or maybe the relationship will be stopped. But
in case of Hegumen Nikan, there was nothing similar. So he always gave absolute freedom to all people
who could
have been considered as his spiritual children. He said, that's just my piece of advice.
And
usually he tried to give advice from the Holy Fathers, not his own ideas.
He
referred to Saint Ignatius Brancheninov and said that you can follow this advice or not follow this advice if you encounter some spiritual issues, and there must be no consequence for the relationship. I have mentioned Saint Ignatius Brancheninov, and I would like to say at once that Hegumen Nikan always paid attention of his acquaintances or his spiritual children to Saint Ignatius Brancheninov. His writings were regarded by Hegumen Nikan as the best spiritual teaching, because it is close to us in terms of our ability of understanding the pieces of advice. His language is close to ours, but apart from that, Saint Ignatius Brancheninov
древних отцов, у которых часто можно найти очень возвышенные и глубокие идеи, так он переложил на язык доступный не в плане слов выражения, а в плане сил и возможностей современного человека.
Он переложил
на наш довольно элементарный духовный уровень и вот применительно к нашему духовному уровню те советы о духовной жизни, которые столь необходимы человеку,
apply as the modern people who have no knowledge or spiritual experience. What was he like in everyday life?
First of all,
he was a very simple man in communication, but he also worked physically a lot. You know, when he could afford help,
but
even at that time he did everything himself. For example, he needed to heat the house where he lived
with coal.
And you know that when you need to sweep out this coal and ashes that burnt out, it's difficult to load and unload that, to heat it. And he got up early in the morning in winter at 5 or 6 a.m. and started doing that.
Он очень много трудился в огороде. Был такой, знаете ли, у него, видимо, хороший такой христианский закал. Да, и, видимо, жилка была крестьянская. Он же родился в крестьянской семье.
Sort of a village man. And maybe he inherited this desire. He knew how to do all of it. He planted everything there. Not just potato, but onions and garlic and tomatoes and everything. And he planted a huge garden for that time.
Только яблонь, груш, вишень, слив,
about 70 trees
в огромном количестве
apple trees, pear trees,
всех видов смородины,
plum trees, and many,
одним словом, у него это,
bushes
была вот эта усадьба,
berries,
это недалеко от храма совсем,
and not far from the church, there was a manor house,
работал вовсю.
And here he worked
его,
a lot.
Михаил Николаевич,
his brother,
был агрономом и работал в Тимирязевской академии, и он оттуда привозил черенки самых различных сортов яблок.
Academy,
так вот, большинство и зернышек,
seedlings
и яблока выращивал
трески,
и затем,
Nikon,
когда тот привозил эти черенки, начиналась прививка. Прививка, потом отрезка и так далее.
Трудился, причем он как.
Он был человеком такого характера, я бы сказал, достаточно горячего. Он трудился до пота, возвращался туда весь мокрый от пота. Вот такой он был. Человек, увлекающийся трудом.
He often came back sweaty, and he was fond of physical work. And at the same time,
он ложился в 12 часу
вырубить.
По крайней мере, до 11, что он постоянно, это, так сказать, было очевидно.
Or
ну, и я
at least at 11 p.m. always, and in the last years,
жил. И поэтому говорю, в общем, он после,
I lived
ложился, после 12,
near him,
быть,
and
11,
I know for sure
знаю,
that he went to bed really late, and he got up at 5 or 6 a.m.
Если было бы богослужение,
and never later. If there was a divine service, he woke up at 5 a.m. and said his morning prayers, and
он приходил к литургии,
he came to the divine liturgy,
раньше,
absolutely prepared,
там,
he came
то,
earlier, and he did
образом,
everything he had to do.
Он вступал, так сказать, в день,
so that's how he entered a new day
праздников, накануне воскресных дней, он
God's
обязательно
grace.
Читал
Before Sunday, he always read the Holy Fathers and their explanations of gospel, and he got ready to preach, and he always said, when I come out to preach, I often change my mind and speak about a different matter, just because when I look at people, and I speak about something else. And he preached really well, and he exemplified his words with the statements of holy fathers, and his preachings were very profound. His attitude to people was different. How can you explain that?
Probably
he could see something in every person.
Приехала одна женщина,
one woman
откуда очень издалека,
arrived from some distant city.
Какие-то у нее были трудные обстоятельства.
She heard about him, and she had some difficult life circumstances.
Он ее принял
he accepted her very friendly.
И исповедовал ее.
And he confessed
сказал,
her,
чтобы она на следующий день причащалась.
And told her to take the Holy Communion on
пришла
the following day. And so she did. Then she came to him and
говорит,
told
нет,
him
нет,
she
нет,
would leave on the following day. He He said, no, please stay. Tomorrow you need to take the communion again. She was surprised. She said, I am in a hurry. But she did what he'd told her, and she stayed and took the Holy Communion. She came to him again and said she would leave. No, please, stay for one more day. We were very surprised because that had never happened before. She said, but no, Father, I cannot go for it. People are waiting for me in Moscow. But she did as he'd told her again. And he spoke to her with great love. She stayed and she took the Holy Communion for the third time, and he told her that she could leave. And she went to Moscow and was hit by a tram, and she was killed.
Поразительно.
So it's
здесь,
amazing.
Вы знаете, в этом случае не возникает никаких сомнений, что он готовил ее к святой кончине.
He was preparing her.
Так вот, но был другой случай. Пришла к нему жена местного главного хирурга.
A wife of a very famous local surgeon came to him.
Очень известным человеком.
He was a very famous man.
And считали, что это очень хороший врач.
He was considered to be a very good doctor.
Он скончался.
He
и она пришла к нему.
Had died, and his wife came to Father Nikon. And here, to our surprise, we saw
тоже непонятное, как и в первом случае, но в другую
strange attitude.
Сторону. Он начал ей говорить
he
о другом.
Started talking to her
начал говорить о том,
about
что вы вот считаете,
he said,
что ваш муж, поскольку сделал столько
husband,
операций, поскольку все его
поставляли,
поскольку он был значимым человеком, вы думаете, что он уже теперь свят?
So you believe that he is in paradise already? For that reason, you're deeply
так очень серьезно на эту тему. Она ушла чуть ли не в слезах, а может быть даже в слезах. В чем дело? Спрашивали.
We asked him,
он говорит,
why?
Она,
and he explained
она
us
вместе с своим мужем
that together with her husband,
попалась бедная в сети,
she fell into trap,
не только в тщеславии, а гордыни
настоящей. But of pride, and nobody would ever tell her about it. She had to understand this and to stop priding herself, because everything we do in this life has value in God's eyes to such extent to which it's done not out of pride.
Ибо все эти три категории,
vanity,
они оскорбляют, если хотите, Бога, и уничтожают все то добро, которое, как кажется, делает человек.
The good deeds that
у
него
много было родственников,
do.
Были знакомые,
there were many relatives
и приезжали
of his
летом,
and many acquaintances,
во время отпуска.
Who arrived in summer during vacation.
Причем говорил
he
не о политике, как это часто
people,
принято у нас, не о всяких сплетнях, о том, что там где-то что-то происходит.
Он
постоянно пользовался, что называется, каждой минутой, лишь бы только поговорить о вещах духовного порядка.
Скажем
так, что для многих этих и его родных,
that for many relatives and acquaintances
совершенно необычное.
It sounded unusual, because you know, when we meet, what do we discuss? Well, you know,
different
unimportant issues. And here he always paid attention to the most important questions of our spiritual life. First,
он настойчиво и постоянно говорил о том, что признаком правильного настроения или устроения такой духовной жизни является не ревность даже, не ревность по внешним церковным делам, ну, посещение богослужений, например, исполнение молитв, правил, постов и так далее. Не это, говорит, является критерием, если хотите, не показателем церковности человека, а является совсем другое.
Another thing
это нужно делать,
of course,
но
we
только
need to
при
do
одном
all
условии
it,
это может служить добро. Верным и самым правильным признаком духовного устроения человека является видение своей греховности. И он говорил, как удивительно, мы все насквозь грешны, ни одной минуты, кажется, не проводим мы в том, что это можно было назвать исполнением заповедей Божьей, и грехов своих не видим.
Way,
он любил перечислять и говорить, посмотрите, какие мы тщеславные, какие завистливые, какие мы недотроги, какие мы гневливые, и уж и прочее, и грехов своих не видим. Так вот, на что он обращал внимание, и почему я сейчас и говорю, он повторял, я бы так сказать, внушал, так, что мы поняли, что критерием правильного духовного направления в жизнь человека является все большее видение вот этих грехов. Мы
is gradually increasing ability to see our sins, because we can only see the most terrible things, like robbery, fornication, and so on, and we can see so-called details, and we don't regard them as sins, but when we pass evil judgment on people is a great injury for our soul.
Неисцельные в душе человека. Гордыня, как она убивает человека. Вот и мы этого
and
не
pride
так
kills
вот,
people,
одним из
and we can't
главных,
see that.
Я бы сказал, направлений so, его мысли была эта мысль о критерии, в истинном признаке того, где мы находимся, кто является верующим.
Вы
знаете, это некоторых
you know,
просто это шокировало.
Some people were shocked by it, because it turns out a believer is a person who starts seeing their sins better and better.
И я вам скажу,
and I can tell you that
regarding this,
he had some discussions with the intelligent people who sometimes said, Father, don't think that we are such people. We have a lot of spiritual experience. We have been attending church for decades. We confess and take communion. And he joked, yes, and you light up candles. And such words of his
caused
some defiance in some people, because, of course, he touched the spot which hurts in people, because many people think they are really nice people, and they are told they aren't. Oh, how terrible it is.
Вот это было направление, одно из главных направлений его мысли.
He spoke a lot about repentance. He said that Christianity is a unique religion because it gives people,
the means to cure our wounds
caused by our sins. And this cure is repentance.
Он объяснял такие фундаментальные понятия христианской жизни, о которых говорят, но не объясняют. Что такое смирение? Что такое любовь?
About,
что мы говорим о смирении и любви? А что это
what
такое? Как правило, действительно, можно услышать
we
очень много говорят
of them, but
о смирении, говорят
really
о любви,
understand what
говорят о молитве,
that means.
И в то же
they
время
speak about humility and prayer,
but not often can you encounter a proper explanation
of how you can acquire this humility, of how you can acquire this Christian life, of what the true prayer is, and I think that it's real bliss to meet a person who can explain these things. Christ said, for if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same?
Что такое смирение?
What is humility? It's not slavery. It's not flattery to power. It's not flattery in face of the power. It's not weakness. Not at all. The true humility results in our ability to see our sinfulness and our inability to cope with it on our own.
And
when I speak of our personal communication with him, I would like to point out a few things. For example, there was one unusual fact. You know, many people who know the conversation of Матавилов and Saint Seraphim of Sarov know about the wonderful scent and the light that Матавилов describes. So I can tell that I witnessed myself when sometimes Father Nikon came out of the room after the prayer, it was impossible to look at him. Because of the light, it's not the usual light, not the electric or sunlight, but the light that he gave off. It happened a few times. And I insist that it was impossible to look at him. Of course, he never brought it up himself,
and
it was not possible for me to tell him that, but he was a great ascetic person, and indeed, he had the special gifts. It goes without saying, it was obvious. I can describe you a few cases to prove my words. Once he and me, we went to the bathhouse and we got so overheated in that bathhouse that we were unconscious, and thank God that our cousin found us on the floor. So he called an ambulance. We were brought out from the bathhouse, and I was young, of course, I became conscious quite quickly, and he couldn't become conscious for a long time. But, you know, the doctor who arrived was shocked, as well as the people who saw it, that Father Nikon, while he was unconscious, he kept seeing in whisper the Jesus' prayer, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Everyone was amazed, no one knew if he had the unceasing prayer or not, and here it became so obvious that was a person who had the unceasing prayer.
Он был, обладал даром чудотворения. Знаете, вот об этом.
Miracle worker.
Сейчас так все ищут чудес.
You know, today everyone is searching for miracles.
Говорить об этом.
You know,
sometimes
it's psychologically difficult for me to speak about it, because everyone is looking for miracles.
Об этом человеке.
And we are talking about this man now. And I never tried to advertise this or to say about this, because you understand, but yes, he could work miracles. You know, the case with the cat can just make you smile. But here are a number of different cases.
Моя мама болела туберкулезом.
My mother had tuberculosis, and she had the tuberculosis of lungs, so her temperature was 37.5, and at the time there was no way to cure it,
so
death was coming. He cured her, and she lived
93 года.
To be 93 years old.
Её родная сестра.
Her sister.
Моя тётя Поля.
My aunt Поля.
Однажды в 5 часов утра прибегает её
Once,
дочь.
At 5 o'clock in the morning, her daughter ran up to our house.
Перепуганная.
And she was
стучится, да.
Frightened.
К батюшке.
She
батюшке
knocked.
Умирает моя мама.
To us and said, Father, my mother is dying. Her pain is insupportable. She's almost dead. What should I do?
Father
took one spoon of wine,
кагор,
and gave to her mother. And after that, she fell asleep. And
then
for many years she had no such fits again. So it's obvious that a spoon of wine cannot cure a person in this condition. Personally, I was 1.45 meters tall.
I didn't grow.
I had a back problem and I stopped growing up. But then once he called me up to himself. It was in the end of May. He called me up.
Берёт линейку, карандаш,
he
вот так, Лёша.
He made me stand
ну, померяем,
next to the door. He took a ruler and a pencil, and he measured my height and
затем,
made a mark on the door. Then two or three days later, he called me up again and measured my height again, and I was taller. Then 3 days later, again he measured it, and I was taller. And this continued until the middle or end of August, I don't really remember right now. And then in August he measured my height, and then in the end of August he stopped doing that. But I liked it. And I kept asking him for it. And he said,
Бога, да?
Would you like to be taller than our Lord? Yes. And he stopped. He started suddenly and he stopped suddenly. And when I came to school on the 1st of September
класс,
and I entered the classroom,
так, то вопль, ну, конечно,
so
все девчонки, естественно,
the girls
золотые. Ой,
shouted, oh, Alec, grew up so much. So over those 2.5 months, I radically changed. It's a pity that I didn't measure exactly how many centimeters taller I became. But I remember this impression on my classmates, so I grew up a lot and I changed a lot. So I think that was about 15 centimeters over 2 months.
But
the main point is that he started doing it suddenly. And he stopped doing it suddenly. But usually at this age it takes children 2 or 3 years to grow up that much. No,
Это, конечно,
it lasted 2 or 3 months, and that was over.
Потрясающе.
And that was an amazing case in my life.
Еще один случай.
There was one more case.
Одной девушкой, у которой руки и ноги едва-едва двигались, которую привозили, и которая, наверное, вот сегодня расскажет нам еще поподробнее,
hands and legs could not move. I think she will tell us today herself. He cured her and she became absolutely healthy. She became a tailor and now she is over 80 years old and all her life she has been working as a tailor. When I got ill, I was 16 years old. And I spent these young years at hospitals. I went to many hospitals in Moscow. My arms didn't work, my legs didn't work. I couldn't take a needle because when I tried to take it, I was so weak that a needle fell out of my hands. And I came to Father Nikon. He confessed me, and I took the Holy Communion. There was a divine service, and in the evening, 2 priests were standing at the door of the church with the shroud of Christ. And when I came up to the shroud, Father Nikon put the shroud of Christ on my head. And when he did it, I felt the good air, but I didn't understand anything. And then, after the service, we went home. I came home, and I realized I could do everything with my hands. I said, "Mom, look, my hands started working." And she said, "Thank God." And Father Nikon didn't tell me anything, and I told him nothing. I didn't understand anything at once. And then she was amazed. "Oh, your hands work." And my sister was 6 or 7 years old.
У нее живот болел.
And she had a stomach ache.
Говорят, ну подойди к батюшке туда, подойди.
And she was told, please go on to Father Nikon. And she went to him.
Он начал спрашивать, ну как ты, что ты,
he started asking her.
Потом дал ей какую-то денежку, она даже не помнит, но большая денежка была. И она выходит, размахивает этой денежкой.
And she came out with this bill.
А потом вспомнила.
And then she remembered.
Это буквально, это же несколько минут.
I have no more stomach ache. So that was just 2 or 3 minutes later, and that's it.
Таких случаев была масса.
There were many cases like this, as I say.
И все они характеризуются одним удивительным свойством.
Can be characterized by the following.
Как-то они проходили
незаметно.
Как-то совершенно
visual effect. They went unnoticed. You know, it seems that with my height, it's an amazing case, but you know, it was percepted as something natural, nothing special.
So,
without any prior warning, I boarded a train and went to Father Nikon. And when this house was being built out of bricks, there was a very tall fence, and it was not possible to see who was there. And it was always locked. And I thought, how can I enter? Maybe I would need to climb the fence because it was not possible for people to see me. And when I was coming up to the fence, Father Nikon opened the gate and came out, you know, as if he was expecting me. You know, there were many, many cases
происходили с окружающими людьми, которые касались различных сторон их жизни.
And
потом,
there were miracles
встал,
in different
поняли,
life spheres. And only when he died,
потому
we realized
жизни,
what had been happening.
Более
because
того,
when he was alive, it seemed natural. And, you know, I thought that all the priests were like him. I didn't know any other priests at that time.
Он мне посоветовал поступать в семинарию,
and
хотя мне
he
предлагали
recommended
даже,
that I would enter the spiritual seminary.
Сказал,
I studied well at school, and I could enter a few
тоже.
Very good institutes, and he said that I should go to the seminary. You know, he was a very educated man. He was like Dostoevsky or Saint Ignatius Brenchaninov. What was he like? He had a great thirst and search for the sense of his life. So what is the sense of my life? If
было чрезвычайно
напряжённое.
Я не могу не сказать,
and
это,
so
что родившись в деревенской семье,
so he was born in a regular village
как он говорил, и все православные
you know,
ходили в церковь,
seemingly he was orthodox,
отстаивали, говорит,
he attended
службу,
church,
ждали, когда она окончится,
he
эта служба,
attended the divine
потом,
service, and he waited
школу,
for it to end, but
then,
when he went to school,
сказали, что Бога
he
нет.
Was told that there is no God.
Это в 900-х годах,
so it's amazing. It was in the beginning of the 20th century. It was before the Bolshevik Revolution.
Потому что всюду пропаганда была, что наука
decided to study science because there was a great propaganda that only science can open everything to people. Then he saw that science like physics, biology, chemistry and so on put no such a question as the sense of life. He turned to philosophy and he studied it very seriously. He studied the philosophy of the ancient Greece, and he read the German and French philosophers in the original because he learned himself the French and the German languages. He was a very talented man. It's unbelievable. He was a great stylist. He could write texts easily. He played the violin. He was the head of the choir in Minsk. He could draw so well
then то его следующие младшие братья, когда поступили в эту школу, так говорят, и мы учились, и его картины, которые он нарисовал, еще висели в качестве образцов.
To see as good examples.
He could
draw well. So he was so talented in different ways. He taught mathematics at school. And I remember that once when I was in high school, there was a sum that nobody could resolve. I came up to him. And he managed to do that, and the teacher was so surprised, and I couldn't tell that it was the priest who managed to do it. So I received a good note, and I received someone else's fame at that point. So when he graduated and he didn't find the sense of life in philosophy, he entered the Institute of Psychology. So he studied there for 2 years. And according to him, after that, he didn't finish his studies because there they were describing the perceptions, the feelings,
the
soul was not mentioned at all, and there was no question of the sense of life, and that's why he dropped out. So
институт какой, Петроградский.
It was the institute in St. Petersburg.
Может быть, стоит сказать.
Maybe I should also say that.
Что он, как он нашел Бога. Мне кажется, это очень важный вопрос.
Met God in the following way. So I think it's very important.
Я бы сказал, что в школе он веру потерял полностью.
So at school he lost his religious faith at all.
Уроки закона Божьего.
He said that their lessons of God's law had been turned into the hours of evil jokes and black humor and blasphemy. Can you imagine that teacher?
So в первых рядах революционеров
that's why there was no wonder that
выпускники духовных школ,
the graduates of the spiritual schools sometimes became participants of the revolution. So after all these years of search for the sense of life, and still he had no answer to the question, what do I live for? Why does humanity exist? So he could not find that in science or philosophy or psychology. And he was disappointed in everything. And he said that he came up to the state of absolute despair. And once, according to him, it was in 1915, so he was 21 years old.
Once,
in this terrible state, he said, God, if you exist, you can see I don't need anything here. Please open up to me if you do exist. I don't need anything. And he claims that suddenly God opened to him in such a way that he had not the remotest doubt, as if after a cloudy, dark, overcast day, suddenly the sun appears, and nobody can confuse it with the street lamp. Everyone is sure that it's the sun. And he says, I felt and I survived it with such great force that I fell down to the floor in tears. And I not just expressed my gratitude, but it was the state that I'm ready for everything. I'm ready to die. I'm ready for any sufferings, deprivations. But please, God, don't leave me. And that lasted for quite a long time.
Then
it so happened that he had to rent one part of the house, one half of the house, and another half was separated by some boards. And in the other half of the house, the young people met boys and girls, and they often asked him to come. He was a nice-looking, attractive young man. He was an interesting conversationalist, a very lively person. He said that it was absolutely not interesting to him. He said, I was even scared to go there and to do something so nonsensical. So for the few years after this, he said, five potatoes were enough for me and one half of bread.
He said,
God gave me the ceaseless prayer, and it is impossible to explain this state, because if the heart is cold, all these words seem nonsensical. He says that everything else seemed like a distraction to me, and only this prayer was enough for me. It was so fulfilling. And then later he entered the Moscow Spiritual Academy. And here he, who had been an atheist in his past, and then later he encountered God, and he had a desire not only to have the personal experience of God's existence, but he wanted to have some argumentation which could prove the truth. And he met the professor Paul Florensky, who spoke about it a lot. And he said that he followed the professor to all his lectures. But he didn't study for a long time, because in 1919 the Theological Academy was closed. Then, according to his words, he became a teacher at Soviet school. He taught mathematics, but he kept attending church. Of course, it was noticed, and when
once
there was an order from the authorities to study on the first day of Easter, he said, "I cannot do that," and he was fired at once. So you see, he had firm convictions, and
школы,
when he
а
was
он преподавал в это время в Вышнем Волочке. Он переезжает в Москву и здесь устраивается жить при одном храме одного священника. В каких условиях? Жил на колокольне
at the
не только
belfry,
но и зимой.
Not just in summer, but also in winter.
Здесь он садясь близко с этим священником, вместе с ним же уезжает в Минск.
Together with another priest, he went to Minsk.
Уже в епископа, и
and
там,
that priest
Минске,
became a bishop.
Его арестовывают
and
и ссылают в лагеря.
Hagumen Nikan was arrested and sent to the concentration camps. They called him the first
комсомол
member. Why?
Because большую группу комсомольцев.
A small group of people of Komsomol members were building the town Komsomolsk-na-Amure, but they didn't build it in the long run, they ran away. He spoke of the terrible conditions there, but he never went into detail. But when he read the book One Day of Life of Ivan Denisovich by Solzhenitsyn, he said, I think Solzhenitsyn couldn't write the truth, or maybe he lived in some privileged concentration camp, because his description is a resort. Can you imagine the book One Day in Life of Ivan Denisovich is a resort? So how terrible it was there. But before all these things, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and prisons. You will be brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake, but it will turn out for you as an occasion for testimony. Therefore, settle it in your hearts not to meditate beforehand on what you will answer. For I will give you a mouth and wisdom which all your adversaries will not be able to contradict or resist. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But not a hair of your head shall be lost. By your patience, possess your souls.
То, что его освободили в 37 году.
Хагуман Никон left prison in 1937.
Он заработал себе дни за переработку.
Some days because he had overworked a lot. It was a real miracle. Because one month later, a so-called Kirov shot happened.
Все зачеты рабочих дней.
And all these days of overworking were annulled, and no one else could leave prison. So Хагуман Никон recommended that I enter the spiritual seminary. We lived together for 3 years, and during that time he prepared me to enter the seminary. But we didn't have the regular programs. So he made me read the philosophers of ancient Greece, then the Russian philosophers on the one hand, can you imagine? And on the other hand, I had to read John Climacus,
Эбба Дорофей.
So he was trying to give me
я через три года поступил сразу в выпускной класс семинарии, в четвертый.
So
я действительно увидел, что
the fourth year of the spiritual seminary at once, and I realized that the educational level of mine was higher than that of some of my peers, because they didn't learn some of these things. And I should say that
he
kept supporting me in the theological seminary too.
We
were writing letters to each other. It is amazing to read that. So his letters are valuable to all people, to his friends, to his spiritual children, if I can say so.
So
he shows the spiritual life, and very few people can demonstrate the spiritual life in such a way. He is a very educated man who can formulate his thoughts clearly, and he underlines all the time, and even just before his death, he said, please stick to the writings of Saint Ignatius Brancheninov. He is a true teacher given by God to the following generations. And if you want to know anything about the spiritual life and you want to do something meaningful in your life, you will find the answers to all questions in the writings of Saint Ignatius Brancheninov. Writings and letters of Хагуман Никон reformulate the writings of Saint Ignatius Brancheninov. So we can say that Хагуман Никон is trying to make the ideas of Saint Ignatius more understandable for the modern reader. So I am strongly convinced that letters of Хагуман Никон have a great value for us, because these are the writings of one of the holy fathers to people who were looking for the truth, for the real faith, for the spiritual life. So he died in
1963,
until the last days,
он постоянно говорил и убеждал всех окружающих, убеждал в ценности православия, его истинности.
Orthodoxy is the true faith, that it is
сначала удалось,
the true value.
Я помню, записать многое, но потом, к сожалению, все эти записи однажды исчезли.
Many words of his, but then
на Пасху
these records disappeared. On Easter day, the burglars broke into my house and they took them away.
Забрали эти катушки, забрали записи, даже некоторые записи, которые были сделаны с этих катушек. Так что, к сожалению, очень много
notes I made from these records, but what we still have,
слава Богу, ценное наследие, которое, видимо, нам
valuable heritage that is probably enough for us.
One of the interesting cases,
which also
demonstrates
his spirituality,
is as following.
For the last 10 days of his life, Hagumen Nikan couldn't get up from his bed. He hadn't eaten anything for 3 months. They say a person can only survive 40 days without food. They are wrong. So he became incredibly skinny. And a few days before his death, he called me up to himself and asked me to find the description of death of Saint Ambrose from Optina. And so I did. And he asked me to read the part
when,
after his death, his body gave off the smell of corruption. So I read this, he thanked me, and that's it. Then, after his death, he was put in the church,
and
his relatives, friends,
по 2 часа
we all
днем и ночью,
took turns,
особенно ночью, читали Евангелие. Положено
two by two hours to read gospel during the day and during the night. That's what should be done when a priest dies.
So
when people came to read gospel,
вдруг пошел сильнейший запах тления.
A very strong smell of corruption could be felt. Of course, we didn't know what to do, because on the following day there would be a funeral and it would be impossible to be there.
And
when people came there on the following day, there was no smell of corruption at all.
There
was a full church of people, the same as on Easter. The clergyman arrived to pray, and there was no smell of corruption whatsoever.
So
I understand it like that he had warned us that we needn't have worried, that the smell of corruption means nothing. Do you remember Leo Tolstoy made fun of Saint Ambrose? I don't want even to repeat his blasphemy. So here
Ambrose остался преподобным. А здесь,
Saint Ambrosius remained the saint. That's not important. And here you see the strong smell at night and no smell in the morning and during the funeral. And I can tell you that after the prayers, there were many people at home. My mother and aunt had cooked some food just for these people. And they thought there would be just 30 people there, but hundreds of people came to the church. And my cousin, who is a very modest person, who had been Father Nikon's friend, who was a priest, announced, "So if you want to commemorate St. Hagumen Nikon, please come in here." Can you imagine what happened? So there was food just for 30 people, and there were 300 people. Oh, that's a disaster.
We asked,
"What have you done?" He just looked down. And do you know what happened next? When we read Gospel, that Jesus Christ fed 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread. Here is the fact that I witnessed myself. So a group of 30 people arrived. They ate, then another group came, another group of 30 people, they ate from the same casseroles, then the next group of 30 people came, and group by group was coming in, and they ate from the same casseroles, and there was enough food. That's how God assured us that when God wants, He can do anything from absolutely nothing. So there was food prepared for 30 people, and 300 people ate it, and there was some food left. So the miracles from Gospel can be repeated. That's why Jesus Christ said that you will do the same as what I did, and even more. That's one more amazing fact in favor of Hagumen Nikon. I would like to tell you that the general impression during his funeral was amazing. You know, it seems we lost such a person that no tears are enough to cry, but there was some amazing joy in the soul.
You know,
I even felt uneasy. I mean, I felt uneasy in front of myself, because why do I feel joyful? My sister came over to my place and we went there, and I didn't know back then that he had already died. So we cleaned everything and sat on the bench, and a woman came up to me and said, "Dear Lisa, do you know that the priest from Jansk had died?" And, you know, suddenly, instead of the sorrow, I felt joy, and I thought, what's happening? Am I crazy? You know, of course, it was very sad for all the people and for me, but at the same time, it was not depressive. On the contrary, there was some spiritual joy and the sorrow was not felt as much as the peaceful state. And later I read in the book by St. Ignatius Brenchaninov that one of the signs that the soul of a late person had been accepted by God is the peaceful joy in souls of all people who are present at the funeral. And here it was an objective fact, not a subjective one, because not one person felt that, but many people did. So that's an objective fact that is impossible to
refuse
and reject,
because
it is impossible to explain that. It was a great loss for all of us. And I decided to visit his grave. I arrived.
So Ольга Михайловна
and I stayed home, and it was already the evening, and we went there. Came up to the church, and I heard in the church the singing.
The
singing was great, and I asked Ольга Михайловна, who was singing there? And she said that no one was singing, there was the lock at the door. Probably you can hear the singing from the railway station. So we went on, and we came to the grave, and I said, oh, it is so bright here. Why? Where is the light coming from? Because it was the evening, and I saw that the light was coming from the grave. It was going to the church and up to the cross, and it disappeared. It was a vision. And when we were standing at the grave, and I felt the smell of incense, and no one had done anything, and this smell of incense, which I felt three times, was the end of that vision, and it stayed with me for all my life, and I have nothing else to tell you. Never in my life have I encountered such a priest again, and I think I never will. You know, by nature, I am a very skeptical person. It's not easy to persuade me. I cannot trust easily, and I always try to be as objective as I can. So I can tell you that after Father Nikon I met, and I still know many clergymen. When he was alive, I was naive enough to think that all priests are like that. And then I met very spiritually pure priests who were saints as children. Yes, they were pure, but they were like children indeed. They had no such wisdom, such spiritual power, such God-given wisdom that was present in Hagemann Nikon.
Это действительно святой.
Indeed, he is a saint. But please,
я хочу, чтобы его канонизировали.
Don't think that I want him to be proclaimed saint. I'm afraid of it. I have reasons to be afraid of it. You know, these days when they proclaim someone saint, they dig up the grave. And I don't want this. I like, you know, when a saint is under a sarcophagus, but the fact that Father Hagemann Nikon is a saint, I have no doubts at all.